thank you to be here all. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. I give a lot of thanks to Marilyn Gang and the Toronto Dowsers that I met in September. And it's through her that I was invited here at the ASD convention. So I would present you ElectroCulture. It's a name I give to a lot of new techniques, new ways that you can use in agriculture to grow plants or to use in your garden. Without the use of fertilizers or without the use of chemical products against sicknesses and so on. So it's all new ways we don't hear about, or maybe we hear about here at the ASD convention, but in the mainstream media we never hear about that, or very less, because it don't make a lot of money in the business, because when you know the way how to do it, you don't need help from outside. You can do it all for yourself. And so, I present me. I'm an agronomist. I'm engineer in agriculture. I had my degree 10 years ago. And I was always interested how to cultivate or how to grow crops differently. Because while I was studying, I grew up in a farm that was really close to nature, and we didn't use a lot of pesticides, really very few only. I didn't know a lot about it, but then when we began to study, I learned a lot. I learned almost only in the books, and the professor, they always talk only about using pesticides. Mm-hmm. When you have a problem, they say, you have to use that pesticide. When you have this problem in your soil, you have to use that fertilizer. And I saw that it was all chemicals, and I was thinking, oh my God, if I have to eat a potato with all that chemicals, where we spray every week chemical products on it, it's like you go in your garden and you spray pesticides, or it's like you take your food and you spray pesticides on it before eating. That's the way agriculture is now in a lot of cases. And I said, oh my God, that is not possible. And so I become interested in new ways of agriculture. And so I read books, like a lot of you know about the books, The Secrets of the Soil, or The Secrets of the Plants, or The Secrets of Nature, written by Christopher Bird and Peter Tompkins. And that really opened my eyes to a lot of new techniques. So I decided to experiment a lot of those techniques. And there was a chapter about the influence of music on plant growth. And I was really sensitive to the bird songs, because where I grew up, I wake up in the morning by the bird songs. So I was really amazed that when I go in the cities, it was only the noise of the cars and things like that. This was horrible. And I was thinking bird songs, everything in nature is useful. It's not just a song. It has also his functions. And so I made a thesis in Antwerp about everything about the influence of sounds, frequencies, sounds, music on plant growth. And there are a lot of techniques. It's really, you can create a university only to learn how to use sound, and even in healing, but also in agriculture. And so when I was continuing my research in that field, I would show you some of the results. So here, that's an experiment I did in the University of Ghent in Belgium. So I'm from Belgium origin. So here you have tomatoes, tomato plants. They are to the roof, up to the ceiling. And here you have the same tomato plants, but they are a lot more weak and a lot more less growth. And this was just with 6 minutes of a certain kind of music each day. So you see how powerful music can be. But music, it's like, if you just hear noise or just a kind of music, you don't like you're on the radio, you put that on the plants or you give that on the plants, you would never have that result. Because it's like a key. You have to create the music that is like that would be in resonance with certain processes in the plant that would stimulate that. And when you have a key, you need really less energy. Even just 6 minutes is enough. It's like you have
a strong box.
Is that? It's like you have a strong box. You can open it with explosives and bombs and so on. It's a lot of energy, but if you have just the key, the white coat, you open it just with two fingers. And that is the same with music and frequencies. When you have the right frequency, you can do really amazing things. It's like you can do really, really amazing things. Just the right frequency can heal somebody or can create a lot of results on plant growth too. And in the song of the birds, you have those frequencies because the plants grow up in the evolution with the bird songs. What is interesting to know is that the flowers in the evolution appears at the same time as the birds. So that's really important because they sing. The birds, they sing in springtime. And they sing not only in springtime, they sing before everything begins to grow. I don't know if you observe that, but now you would observe that because you know it. It's that at the end of the winter you begin to hear all the birds beginning to sing, and then afterwards only you see all the seeds germinating and all the plants begin to flower and to grow. It's really that there's really a connection. And they sing differently over the day than in the morning or in the evening or in the summertime or in autumn. It's really a language. And it's really, they are really in resonance with nature. And those effects you can also have, like Shaman people or Indians, when they want to heal somebody, they put them like in trance or they study or they feel the patient, and they put them like in trance and they say, oh, you need that plant or that plant because the spirit tells him. It's not that he learns that from generation to generation. No, it's not like that. He said, I'm connect me to the spirit, and up. I received the it's like dowsing. You just have to connect you and be very sensitive and be in phase, in tune with nature. And there's a book like that, In Tune with Nature by Philip Callahan. And it's the same with those kind of music. You can do it by a scientific way. I have all the formulas. I can calculate the frequencies you need and so on to increase plant growth, or to increase the sugar level in a tomato, or to stop the growth of a plant. I can make all those sounds. You can make really amazing things, but I don't use it really that way. But you can also use it like the Indians. They just connect. They don't need all the formulas and calculators and computers and so on. They just connect them to the nature, and they have even more better results. And it's a more holistic approach. And that's so it would be in most cases a better result too, because So that's an example what you can do. But those sounds can also be dangerous. You have to be careful with everything. So that's another example. That's with a technique like Sonic Bloom from the US. He copies like bird sounds, and he takes certain frequencies that he send out to stimulate the stomato and to stimulate the respiration of the plants. And when you spray them then with products with algae, you have really amazing results. And there you have, that's red beets. They are two times as big. You see the leaves are bigger, the beets are bigger. That's a power the same. And there's another technique. That's another technique. Here you see biodynamic wine grower. And he puts also classic music, Vivaldi and things like that, classic baroque music. And you see the vines in autumn, they're really green, good, and in good health. And there you see the other that was just next to it, of a conventional chemical farm, and he was like this. So when you see that, I think he has to think about his way of doing, and yeah, that's really important. Also, when you grow food like this with the energies, like here it's music, but I would tell about new other ways with other energies. When you grow like this, it increases also the vitamins and the salts and all the nutrient ingredients of the plant. It's not like in a chemical or conventional farm. They put fertilizer. They have big plants sometimes, but it's all water. It's all water, and sometimes they are even like in the wheat. You have gluten, and then you make allergies. But if you have a really biodynamic and a good wheat, even the people that have allergies, they can eat it and they don't have problems. So it's not the gluten that is a problem, it's the quality of the gluten that is a problem.
What kind of music? Classical music? And do you do it at what frequency? Not sound frequency, but what time?
Yes.
1 hour a day? Or
here you have the whole day classic music. And here that's only 2 hours a week.
2 hours a week?
Yeah, that's not much here.
Did you say it was classical?
Yes, here it's classic, but you have so much techniques, I don't have enough time to tell you all. But I would tell you some techniques you can do in your garden more at the end. And for the questions, please write them down and tell them at the end. So I would take a little time, 10 minutes, a quarter at the end for the questions. And then you can also come at the vendor table. I have nothing to sell, but you can come there to talk with me and to ask your questions, and we can exchange, because you also have your experience that you can exchange, and it would be very nice. Now, how did I put the link between magnetism and music? That's very interesting. I was thinking it began with a problem with a farmer. It was a farmer, he was interesting to put music in his field. But he was not ready to go in his field every morning and to sing. Because he didn't have all the time for it, and he is not a good singer. So, but you have to know that there are certain Indians, Indian tribes, even now in Ecuador, where all the women every morning they go in their fields and they sing. It exists, and in the past, all over the world, they did that. All over in Africa, you have also songs. They have even songs to bring the wind. When there is a dwarf, they make like a ritual and they sing certain songs and they bring the wind. There was one experiment that was in Ottawa. There was by Weinberger. He takes certain songs he found in a museum about old agricultural songs for plant growth. And he takes all the songs you hear everywhere and classical music, and he did a comparison on wheat seed germination. And he discovered that the weeds grow by the song. They germinate and they grow 30 or more percent more rapid than the other. So it's not just a song, it's not just a tradition. There is a reality in that. There is really something that works. It's not just a song. And so I think we can learn a lot by the elders, by other techniques, even if we don't understand it completely. We have to listen to them, because it comes from generations of generations, thousands and thousands of years of experience, and what we think we know now with science is only really a very little piece of the reality. And so how I come to the influence of magnetism on plant growth. You know maybe all about semantics, about how you can put certain frequencies on sand particles, and with certain frequencies you see geometrical structures appearing. And what is interesting, here you have like a photo, it's not a real photo, but it's like a cartoon, about the magnetic field of the Earth. And in dowsing you learn, you have lines, north, south, every so much meters, and east, west, and you have other lines crossing, and you can measure even with scientific instrument that the magnetic field changes. And that's the reality. But normally a magnetic field, there is no structure in a magnetic field. It's just a field of energy that is all everywhere. What I tell now, it's a hypothesis of me. It's just a field of energy everywhere. But what you need to put their structure in it, it's sound. It's like in the Bible and in a lot of other religions, in their history of creation, the world begin with sound. The God speak, or somebody speaks, and it creates light. It's not the light that creates the sound, it's the sound that creates light. You can create light with sound. With certain frequencies, there are monks and gods and that can, when the moisture in the air is enough, they sing certain frequencies and the light come up, because it's a phenomenon of gravitation that can be created. You can explain it scientifically. But you cannot create sound with light. No, you cannot. Yes, you cannot create sound with light, or not at my knowing. And so here you have, that's interesting. Here you make like a geometrical form, which just, that's a frequency 1021 hertz. That's another. And here that's a turtle. And you see in comparison how close it is, just what you can do with sound, with the structure you find again in nature. And what is very interesting is that in a lot of histories, in a lot of mythology, you find that the turtle is the one that holds the world. And then you come back here and you see the magnetic field. It's like the magnetic field lines or the pole. You can see a lot of things in it. And that is not a coincidence, that it's not just in nature. Everything is, there's an order in nature. There are rules, and everything is like that. And you can find that in flowers, geometrical patterns, and those geometrical patterns you can create with sounds, and so on. And it's like energy that is there always, like magnetic energy or whatever you can name it. It's even more complex maybe than magnetic energy. And then it becomes more and more structured. And then at the end you have matter. You have matter. But the matter is only the symptom. It's only what you have at the end. And you can create matter or influence the reality just by working on those energies. And that you know all about. I don't have to learn you. But that you discover with a lot of technique, it goes always in the same direction. And when you... Ah yes, what is interesting too, it's like you have a goal and you fix it. The goal is the matter, and here you are in the energies. In the beginning you have just the intention, and then you have your concentration. And what you do in the beginning, the right intention is the most important. Because if you are not the right intention, you would be just 1 degree like this. At the end is a lot of it's not on the goal. So that's really important. That's one of the most important things. When you do something, is the intention you have in what you do, or the love you put also in what you do, and the intention to work with a greater goal or spirit or nature, with a greater good. And when you help, when you work with nature, it's like you are in a river. When you go against nature, it's very difficult life. You have to swim, you have to put a lot of energy. But when you go with nature, all nature helps you. You begin with a dwarf, and then you are a little river, then you are a big river, and then you are the sea, then you are... All nature helps you to make it bigger and to help you. So I can only advise you to observe nature and go with it and help it and use it too, but also always respectful for nature and with it. And they would show you how to do it. An example, I would show the example of, but we have seen the magnetic field, we have seen sound. And what is interesting with sound is that it's dynamic. Sound is not just one moment, it's always in time, it's dynamic. And here you have another frequency, and you find always the vortexes, the spirals, the vortexes. You can find that even in matter, in nature matter, like a snail, or you can find that in when you have water and you put that frequency, you create like a spiral, and it's always spiraling like that. And you can find that back in nature, magnetic field. It moves, but it's turning too. It's really spiraling. And yeah. Yes, that is also interesting. In convention way of thinking in the physics books, you see always the lines going in the south of the magnetic field, the energy. But the reality is the opposite. Everything that is in physics books, in most cases, you have to know that the reality is the opposite of what is in the physics books. Because, I don't know, they do that maybe intentionally to disturb you or to confuse you, because if it was all reality, it would be a lot easier to learn, because it would be in tune with nature, but that's not so reality. And what is interesting, when you see the Earth at the north, as soon as the frost is stopped, the plants begin to grow very fast. And when you are in the South Pole, even when the frost is gone, you don't have so much big plants and so much energy. And why is that? Is that the plants need that energy. That when it comes from the ground, it helps even the plants grow that magnetic energy. And when you do the opposite, it's not so good for plants. They don't like that so much. But there are plants adapted. And you see that also at the equator. Above the equator, in reality, the magnetic field goes like that, and it comes again here too, and it comes out here. It's not reality. That is not really like this, but that's how they learn us in textbooks. Desert. You have the desert. You have the Sahara. You have, and just at the south of the equator, when it comes out, you have the big rainforest. It is not a coincidence that the Sahara is there and the rainforest just below it. So that's very interesting. And when I learned that, I learned that by reading books and by observing the nature. I say, whoa, that's really amazing. So now an example how I can now use that knowledge in agriculture. So that's an example. In France, you have a lot of peach trees or classic peach. Yes, peach trees are. It's close to peach, and there are new sicknesses because with chemical products in conventional farming, when they found a solution against a problem, they put a new chemical. It disturbs a lot more the environment, and then they have another problem. And it's always like that. They have new problems. And now there are really severe problems, and all the orchards with peach trees, they are dying. They don't have a chemical product to save them. And they are searching, and they spend millions of dollars everywhere. And it's the same for lavender or other problems or other crops. And I looked in the orchard, there were all the trees were like this or this, they were really in bad shape. And I saw a tree like this, really in good shape. I was thinking, why is that tree in so good shape? And then I looked and I saw here, you see that here, that's a snail. But it's a dead snail, but he was like there. Huh. A snail, escargot. a snail is really special. The hypothesis is that here it was like that, and the water can flow in. It holds in the snail. I have one snail here.
So save your escargot shells and put them underneath your tree?
Yes, it can be put that. You have a snail. And that is like in the biodynamic farming, they learn to use horns. And they say the cows, they have their horns, and it collects cosmic energies. Now, in the dairy farms, they cut all the horns of all the cows. And you drink a lot of dairy products, but all of it from farms where the cows don't have horns anymore. So you don't have to be amazed that there's not a lot of spirit in what we do, in what we eat. that's an example, but it's you can see a lot of examples like that. But why the cows have horns? It has a reason in nature. It's not to cut them. And so that's the same. It collects cosmic energies at high frequencies of the earth. You can even, if you have wide devices to measure, you can even measure that. But we don't need really devices to measure. But for people that want proofs, we can do that. And here you see that the tree was going really well. So I was thinking, how can I do? Because there are no so much snails anymore, birds, there are not so much birds anymore, they're all dead. In comparison with 50 years ago in Europe, but I think it's the same here, you have maybe 50% or 70% less birds. It's really, and there are a lot of animals like that. The people think they are there, but they are very less. And so how I was thinking how I can do this in a different way to help nature. And so I created I would explain later. So I was thinking that it shows you also the importance of every animal. You think that one, if you put pellets at your bottom of your trees or in your garden, you think, I have to get rid of my snails. I put a chemical product or something like that, I have to get rid. But then afterwards you see your trees are dying. Oh, I have to do that or to do that. You have to see it always holistically. Everything has its reason, and before doing something or intervent, we have really to observe nature and to be very careful. And also to be careful how we intervent. And never intervent like when you have a plant or a weed or an insect that disturbs you. Never kill them all if you want really to kill them. But because they have their importance. You have to get to exchange with nature. If you respect nature, they would respect you. That's very important. An example of that's more a spiritual way of doing, but that's really connected. I would explain you why. An example: there was a woman. She told me at the vendor table that she grows vegetables, and she told me that when she has deer in the garden. She think about the cougar that's going to do the deers, and she visualize that, she imagine that, and the deers become a little disturbed and they go. So we have so much power. Everybody can do that. It's really simple. It's the same with everything. When you have birds that are always eating your apples on your tree or your cherries or I don't know how to name the cherries, your cherries. If you have three trees of cherries, and they eat them all every year, you say, you sit down and you say, I respect you all. You need cherries to eat to live, but I would like also cherries. So can you let me one tree for me or two trees, and you get the other, and you would see, you would be amazed about the results. In the most cases, it works. That's really amazing. You can communicate like this with nature. You can try so much things in your garden. If you have problems, just make agreements with nature. But then also respect your agreement, because if you don't respect, if you say like in your garden you have too much weeds, you have always to have a corner or a place where you let all the weeds growing their life and you don't disturb them. And you say, yeah, I let you grow there. But if you have the idea and you take all the weeds out on the corner where you said that they would be free, I don't know. That's good. With nature, would do also something to you. I think, but you have to expand. You have always to respect nature, and then it's that's my experience. And what is interesting is magnetic fields. In the Russian has discovered that when you have an electron, it moves, but it has a spin too. It turns right or clockwise or counterclockwise. And in nature, all electrons that moves in our bodies, in the plants, they have a clockwise direction. Maybe there are some counterclockwise, but in my knowing, it's all clockwise. And the magnetic field has then also polarity, like a clockwise polarity or anti-counterclockwise. And what is interesting is that you can influence that by your mind. You cannot create a magnetic field, but you can influence the polarity of a magnetic field just by your mind. But you can also influence it by forms, by geometrical patterns. Every form has an influence on the environment too. And you see, like a snail, when you go from the center, I always looking from the center because it depends on your perspective. But I always looking to everything from the center, from the origin. And when you look from the center, it goes clockwise. So it's interesting. And I never saw counterclockwise snails. But maybe they exist, I don't know. And what's interesting is that you can influence that with your thoughts. And magnetic fields, or the magnetic field of the Earth, I see that as a grid that carries more complex frequencies and information. It's like now everybody knows your cell phone and things like that. A cell phone, it's also, they send a lot of frequencies. But that's just what we developed with science, but nature is a lot more complex. You have like a grid of nature, of magnetic field. You have the Earth, it's a huge magnet, the Earth. It's like you have that magnet, but billions of times bigger, and we are walking on that magnet. And that magnet, that magnetic field vibrates. And depending on the other planet, it would change the vibrations. And all life evolution grows up with those vibrations. It even creates that. And it's like the water. You have all the vibration, you have the Earth with water, and then it becomes structures in it, and then at the end we human beings, and you have flowers, you have birds, it's all result of all those vibrations and the water and all those things. Because the water, that's like an amplificator and an antenna, a receiver, emitter too. And what is interesting about your thought is that you can influence those vibrations. It's like you have that grid, and then you can influence those vibrations. You can create vibrations. You create vibrations because you also magnetic fields. You have a lot of electrons flowing in you. You have chakras, like you know about. That's all kind of magnetic fields and more. That energies that moves and information, and you can influence that just with your mind, but you have just to pay attention to it. It's just a matter of paying attention. In nature, everything you think about, your thoughts create shapes, creates the things. If you think about if you concentrate on a certain subject or a certain idea, it becomes reality. Everything you concentrate, if you have depth, don't think about your depths and your life is the same. Think only about your earnings and not your depths. And your depths, you would see, they would soon disappear. They just disappear because they have no. Think only about your earnings. And I was 30, 40, $50,000 below zero. In one year, almost, I was 30, 40, $50,000 above zero. And it's just about that what I tell you. It's the same. And it was just by your nature helps you when you go with it. And that's the same. And everybody can do it. So I continue for this. So that's examples of what was done in history. So I was interested in the influence of sounds. I was then interested in magnetism and also electricity. There were people that put like antennas like this. The name is a Lakowski coil. That's in the years 30s, 40s. It is just a wire, just an electrical wire. Everybody has wires at home. I can buy that in a store. And you just get them at a certain length. Whatever length it is, it works. But if you doubt the proper length, the best length, it would be better. You doubt the best length. And if you have a plant like a tree that is sick, or geranium, or flowers, or everything you want, and you want to help it a little more, give it more energy, You just take a little wooden stick, you cut the wire, you denude the ends, and you can denude it all too well. And then you just put it like this. You have just that's just a holder. You have just that it stays like that open. It doesn't have to connect. It stays open. And when it stays open, you just close to each other but open. And I put also, that's my special touch, I put also e-wax, because that's magic. That's really special e-wax. But it works only the wire too. And
wax. Beeswax on the end?
Yes. So I have 9:30, so I have 20 minutes. That's beeswax. I let it turn around. You can smell it. It's really wonderful. It's a good quality beeswax. You know, in the churches, there were always beeswax candles, and that's very important. It's not oil. It's not wax from oil. Beeswax, when it burns, it emits a lot of good frequencies for you to heal you. And when you burn or you pray with your, and when you pray with beeswax candles, I'm sure it's a lot more powerful than when you pray with oil-based candles. I think that is not very good. It's maybe good for BP and Shell and things like that. But if it's on and finished and now they. It's because they want the every liter of oil, they want to capture it and take it because of money, and then they give 20 billions of money to their share stockholders, and then they make commercials that they help with $1 billion the people that lost everything because of their things. So we have to be aware of that. And it cannot continue like that. So beeswax is really important. And beeswax, we have to save the bees to have beeswax. And the bees are collapsing. The bees, there's a really big mortality of bees. And I would tell you how you can save the bees. And that you have to tell to every beekeeper you know. With less than $3, they can save their whole beehive. So, I continue for the plants. So, if you have trees or cuts, you can put like this. You make two little holes, and you put this around your tree like this. To stand it, you maybe make two sticks, and you put it like this around your tree. It can be a lot bigger. It can be also like this, as big or even bigger if your tree is bigger. And that would create an oscillation circuit in electronic terms that would create like a frequency, a carrier frequency of very more high frequencies of cosmic waves. Yes?
The diameter, have you done any study on the different diameters?
You can take any diameter you want. But if you douse the best diameter, it would be better. But it works with all diameters.
Must that be copper wire?
in history, they use always copper wire, but there are there are people that do it with other wires and it works too. But I think the best is copper wire.
Would you and put so that actually around the tree or beside it?
Around the tree. Around. You put here, here is the tree.
Yeah. Yeah. So should you
match
the tree?
How?
The wire should not be on the tree, it's like around
The wire is around the tree here. That was a little tree that was on a Hartmann crossing point, and it was not growing well. And I put it this, and it goes well. It was okay, because it gives him more energy. That is an experiment of Lakowski. He inoculated all geranium plants, flower plants, with cancer. And at one, he puts the wire like this,
wow.
and it grows, and it was not sick. Another example, here that's with beeswax and electricity. He sent the beeswax, he sent electricity discharges like a thunderstorms, but it was an artificial with an electronic device. He sent it electricity discharges on beeswax, and then the result electricity of that was a lot of frequencies, and he sent that in the water. And then he sprayed the potatoes with that water. And you see, just after one spray, there were a lot of more germs on the potato. Really, it's just, and that shows you also, that's artificial, but how much is important thunderstorms and the discharges. That creates like all frequencies. There are also books that talk about it, like the book The Magnetic Life of Agriculture from Callahan. The books of Callahan are in English, are really interesting about the magnetic life of agriculture. But that is experiments from Marcel Violet. It's a French scientist of the years 50s and 60s. And after that, yeah, it's okay. He experiment with beeswax.
Montre-le hors du faisceau de lumière parce qu'on ne voit pas le livre. Non.
That's the book, the secret, le secret des patriarches, but it's in French. But I can send you by email in French and PDF. I have it. And that's really interesting books. And he said that beeswax collects in reality cosmic energies, a high frequency. It's like a filter of the good frequencies. And that's what is needed in our agriculture and today way of doing. It's more, it's to be connected with the cosmic energies. There's like a disruption between the earth energies and the cosmic energy because of all our pollution, electromagnetic pollutions, our chemical farming, the chemicals. Because the chemicals, the way of farming today and gardening, it deteriorates the soil, and all the particles that are in resonance with all those magnetic fields, they go away, or they are eroded away, or they go away. And then, when you want to grow plants on those fields, they don't grow anymore if you don't put chemicals in it. Because all the particles that were in resonance with all those life forces are not there anymore. And then it's like a desert. And then you need to, again, with a lot of techniques and with your work, to fertilize in a different way or to help nature to reconstruct and to recreate that magnetic grid, like I would tell it. And so there were a lot of dowsers and people that make experiments with antennas you can put in the garden. That is just like like you see above your roof for taking the thunder. When it's go grounded, you would see at your home the plants around go a lot more than anywhere else because it collects the electricity of nature that is there. It's concentrated and it grows. But it's like Charles Hubbard talk about pyramid energy. Pyramid energy is also like this. It collects also those energies and it concentrates it and it amplifies it. And it creates the connection too between the cosmic energies and the earth energies. And we too, we are like a pyramid. Like when you do this, you see Leonardo da Vinci, you see it. You have like a cone here and here. And go in your garden and just do this, you would see, you would feel the energy. It goes to you. And you do this, you can take your shoes off and to be really in contact with the ground. You do this and then ask if you need rain, ask rain. But ask not just rain, because maybe you would have a flood. So ask 5 millimeter or 10 millimeter. Ask, be really precise, otherwise nature likes a lot to make jokes. And if you are not precise, they would make a joke. And then maybe they sent you a flood, or maybe they sent you just one drop on your, you are screen, maybe they sent you just one drop on your hand. It's possible. That's an example of a device I made that was based on Lakovsky. So I worked also with Jack Benveniste and the memory of Ufu Potter. I don't know if you heard about it. But that's an insecticide, but you have to know that it's not only the insecticide. I would inform the water with the insecticide, but it's not really like that. It's like a radioning device. It's with the intention I want to get rid of those insects. It's and what happens is that the insects go away or they disappear. I cannot tell you what's really happening, but one time I did it on a tree. And there were aphids, a lot of aphids. That is on dahlia's flowers in my garden. I spray it with that water that was informed. There was no any molecule of that insecticide. But I sprayed it with the water that I informed with my device. Just I send it electricity through it, and then I send it to a coil, and the magnetic field informed the water. Just very simple. And there, I sprayed just with normal water without the information, and there with, and you see here you have aphids, and there, no one aphid anymore. And I did that one time on a tree, on a cherry tree, two cherry trees, two all full of aphids. And I sprayed one cherry tree with the water informed, and I gone there 2 weeks later, and the cherry tree was full of ladybugs. So it didn't kill the aphids. It changes the energy, and all the ladybugs, they were really full of ladybugs. I never saw so much ladybugs on a tree, and the tree that was just maybe 30 feet away from there, that was also full with aphids, and not 30 feet, it was like there and there, I don't know how much feet it is, 3, 6, 9, maybe 13 feet or 15 feet. And there, he was still, I did insecticide on it 2 weeks earlier, but 2 weeks after, it was again full of aphids. And the ladybugs from one tree didn't go on the other. So that's really interesting, because it's not just I have to, the ladybugs, they don't go on the other because the energy is different, I think. And that's really interesting. So then, with all that know-how, I decided to make a system, another system, and I made this. And that's a huge magnet. The idea was to increase the grid, the energy of the grid, because when you have a lot more energy, magnetic energy on a field, like you can use also rock dust or magnetite dust or high paramagnetic rock dust, like on volcanoes, like all products from volcanoes or in most cases highly paramagnetic or really in resonance the volcano is like the woman to give birth to the things. It's really fertile, and you can see it symbolically, and then you can also measure in a scientific way, and it's really the same. And the idea was to increase the magnetic field, and so I took huge magnets and I put them all around the field, put them in tune, in the same orientation as the Earth magnetic field. And then I put them, I make also an antenna with seven loops, because you have seven tunes of music, and to collect the most energies as possible, and like a Tesla antenna to take the high frequencies. It's free energy for agriculture. And then I put a copper plate, a tin plate, and also information, you know, maybe about Emoto. I have the information inside. I have made a letter about gratitude, really gratefulness, gratitude I put inside. And that's really important too. It's not just the magnetic field. And then when I made that, the beeswax, when I make this, I be careful that I am good energies. Because it's like you inform the waters, it's your consciousness that would be in it. And so I put that all around the field, and then I put them like this. That's the south pole to the south of the earth. And then I put one in the middle like this, with the antenna to the sky. And that creates like a connection. And I talked to people here that see energies, and that was really interesting, because I don't see energies, but I feel them in a certain way, or I do that. And they say it creates like a dome of energy around on the field, a dome of light energy. It's like you meditate, but it's not as powerful as meditation, but it creates like a dome of energy. And when I put this in the middle, there are always things happening. The weather change, when there's like weather like this, the clouds go open, you have a sunshine, or you have, if it's all blue, you have a cloud and rain, you have really strange things, or a wind, or you have always signs. You can, when you ask something to nature, you can also ask a sign to have the answer if it was good or not, or if they hear you. And I ask that always, and then there is always a sign in the clouds a lot of times. Or you see a heart appear. I see that more and more hearts appear in the sky like a cloud in a heart. Really nice.
How big is the dome?
If your field is 2 acres, it would be 2 acres. If your field is 10 acres, it would be 10 acres. It's everything that is, where I put that around is the limit, around the field. Yeah.
How many magnets do you have to put around?
I put them every 30 to 120 feet to have an ID. And in the beginning, I just put it like an engineer up every 30 feet. Like this, but now I don't work anymore like this, because now I take the watts and I feel where is the best place to put them, and I look at the landscape, I look where are the churches, where are the standing stones, where are the trees, the big trees, and that's big. I look at the whole landscape and I put them at certain places where it's good, and the results are amazing. I would show you that. So, what I show here is that there's energy. It's really free energy. If you put a lamp, it can light up if it's a little lamp.
Really?
I would show you maybe, but I can't if you don't believe me. But to know that free energy is possible, we don't need BP and total and Shell and all those things. So you see, age now, it changes. But in the beginning, it was 30. It raises. That's to have an idea. There's magnetic energy, but also electrical energy and natural from collected. And So I would show, I'm almost to the end, as I explained how I put them around the field with affecting the magnetic field according to the ley lines, the water veins and energetic lines. The odousers in France that learned me a lot, and I use that. I use the solar lines and the Maximus lines, and then also other lines. I asked to nature to tell me where I have to put them, and just as simple as that. And then I go with my words.
What did you say about the bees, to save the bees?
Yes, about the bees, don't remember me at the end and I tell you how to save them. It's two sentences. And so here you see that was the first cabbage field that I did with that system, because I developed that in 2009. That's last year, so it's the first year I did that. And so here you see without, that's a biodynamic farming, and that was a biodynamic farm that he didn't succeed to have big cabbages. He was always very cosmic, and his cabbages the first year they grow two seeds, and all the plants go very high, but they didn't become big, and that's And you have to see that also, as there was an imbalance between the cosmic energies and the earth. And then I thought I have to increase the earth energies. And that's how I made this, with that idea to increase the earth energies and to connect it. And you see, there were almost 2 weeks, they go 2 weeks faster than those, you see. And the leaves were a lot bigger too, the first leaves. You see here, and here the first leaves, they are a lot bigger. Yeah. And you see, that's the first leaves, that's amazing. And they, after in June, there were already 6.9 kilos. They were as big as that. And that farmer, the last 10 years, he only had cabbages or 2 or 3 kilos like this, and he has cabbages or 6 to 9 kilos. It was 2 to 3 fold or 5 fold is normal yield. So the farmer, he was really, whoa, what's happening here? but sometimes when the farmer is not ready to accept that, it makes them afraid sometimes of people. When you're not ready, it makes them afraid. You have to be careful. To
what size magnets?
We
tried.
At the end, I closed very quick. So I made the holes. I take that. That's at a vegetable garden farmer. That was with the group. And that day it was always raining. You see, it's a lot mud. It was a really a rainy day. And that was in 2010. This springtime or end of the winter. That was a group. We were with 5 to 6. That is a farmer, a big smile. That's very nice. And it was always little rainy and sometimes like this. And less than 30 minutes after I put the last one, at the time I put this one, it was wind, really a big wind that was coming to, really strange. And then less than 30 minutes later, it was blue sky. So that's really interesting, and they were like really interesting. And that's in the Drôme. It's a region that is very dwarf in France, and the sky was like this, and there were insects singing like you have in the south of France.
Crickets
or seagull or
cicadas.
Yeah, and the woman was saying, oh, when they sing, You don't have rain for many days. When they sing, you don't have rain. And my friend told me, I told her, ah, but Yannick would solve that problem. And I say, whoa, I'm not too cool. And I go out. I put me like this in her garden, and I ask 5 millimeters of rain. maybe 10 minutes later, I go again inside, 10 minutes later, the seagulls or the cicadas or they stopped making sound. The woman, and there was the first raindrops. Whoa, and the woman was really, really worried. what's happening? I was thinking, because it was really dark, it was not a rainy day, it was, and I was thinking maybe it would rain 5 millimeters and 1 hour, in 1 day or 2 days. But the next morning, they were, like you see on the concrete, there was so much water on it, and on the trees and everything. So there was almost 5 millimeters that was rain. That's in my garden. You see a lot of, I had different kind of sunflowers. That's a gigantic sunflower. So that's normally is big, but he was really very big. And that's a normal sunflower. It was also very big. I had plates like this. Here also sunflower. That's in another garden. You see they grow a lot quicker. And the carrots like really bigger.
So how
you can save the bees? So just simple. That was a beekeeper. He had pain in his back and things, and he put little magnets on his back, and he said, "Whoa, it relieves my pain, nice." And then he said, "Maybe if it relieves my pain, maybe it can help my bees too." And he put two magnets like this. Just if you have the beehive, he put two magnets in attraction on each side of the beehive. And he doubles his production of honey, and he never had any loss anymore of bees. So it's really interesting. And now there are already more than 50 beehives that were treated the last 3 years, and they see always the same result, almost two doubles the production of honey, and they don't have losses anymore. So. Just magnets, just little magnets. They're just heavy magnets. You take a shape, it can be round too, if it's a little, or of like this, it's okay, if you have two. But for more advice, you go to my vendor table and I can tell you. But you can take a lot of different magnets. But don't take neodymium magnets, just take ferrite magnets, they are more natural. All the products.
There's
ferrite, but black ones like this. Yeah.
What are they called?
So now to conclude, because I have to conclude, I can talk about all that 2 days or more. I have different internet sites. You can ask me questions at my email or phone me, but it's better by email. And that's a sign that I learned from a guy that is in contact with certain Indians. And he said you have to draw it. You can draw that in your mind too. Just this sign, 1, 2, 3, 4, and like this. And here you let it open. And here a heart like this. And you let it open also for an open heart. Mm. And that's like a symbol to be grateful and thankful to the earth and to the earth energies and to balance your earth with the four earth energies. The four water, fire, earth, and air. So, it's the intention that is most important, that you are really grateful. When you begin, my life changes completely the day I begin to be grateful to everything what happens to me and to life. The day that I began to be grateful to the things, thankful,